Welcome. Subscribe to AS Foundation, India's leading academy for CA course, and hit the bell icon to get the latest updates. Thank you.
Now we'll take a new concept, chain holding. Okay. In the study material, there is a question on chain holding problems. What do you mean by chain holding problem? There are situations where an entity may be a subsidiary of an investor indirectly. In our notes also it is written, in paragraph number 29. Okay. So no need to write for next few minutes. And take this example. A Limited holds 80% voting power in B. So A holds 80% in B. B holds 60% in C. Now, whether A Limited controls C? The answer is yes. Indirectly through its subsidiary, it controls C because this B Limited has 60% share in C. So they've got 60% share in the voting power of C. So if any decision is to be taken at C's level, B can take the decision because it has got 60% share. And B is a subsidiary of A. So A will control B and through B it controls C. So in this example, A is called ultimate parent. Ultimate parent. And C will be called sub-subsidiary, subsidiary of subsidiary, sub-subsidiary. B has a double role. It is a parent company of C and subsidiary of A. Okay. So we will call it intermediate. What should I write? Parent or subsidiary? Intermediate subsidiary or intermediate parent. These are the words we are coining, we are designing. Okay. Now you will be asked to prepare CFS of which company? A. You will be asked to prepare the CFS of A. If they ask B and C, then it is as usual. What we did in the last so many questions, same thing you will do. But if they ask you prepare CFS of A, now understand A is holding 80% in B, B is holding 60% in C. So what is the net asset of C which A controls? 48%. Is it right? So in that case, while calculating the division of profit of C for A group and NCI, A will get 48% share in the net asset. It is controlling that other party, but in terms of their stake in the net asset, it is 48%, and NCI will get 52% share in the net asset of this C. How this 52% has come? In C Limited, 40% stake is directly held by others. 40 is direct. And in A Limited, sorry, in B Limited, 80% share is with A, 20% is with NCI. So NCI will also claim 20% of the 60%. Is it right? So therefore, 20% of 60%, 12. And there are some direct NCI in C. So 12 plus 40, 52%. So while apportioning the profits of C, you will apportion 48% to A and 52% to C. Is it right? Suppose subsidiary has 100 rupees profit. Now out of 100, 60 goes to B, 40 goes to others. But in B also there are two owners, na? In B there are two owners, A 80%, so A get 80% of 60, 48, and this NCI of B will get 12. So total NCI will get, all outsiders will get in the group 52% in C's profit, 52% in C's profit, and A group will get 48% in C's profit. With respect to A and B, usual calculation, A 80% and NCI 20%. So we are discussing how the C's profit will be distributed. C's profit will be distributed in our example 48% to A group and 52% to NCI. And how the profit of B will be distributed? 80% to A, 20% to NCI. So problem becomes a little complicated in chain holding problem, but they have asked in the exam. Okay, therefore we'll take one or two examples on this also. Now example B, A Limited holds 60% share in B. B is a direct subsidiary of A, and to make your life little complicated, A holds 20% share in C, and B also holds 40% share of C. B also holds 40% share of C. First, you have to check whether A controls C. If yes, then only C will be consolidated with A. The answer is yes, because A and B together, 40 plus 20 together, they are controlling 60% shares of C. They have 60% voting power of C. So any ordinary resolution can be passed by A along with B. They will merge because B is controlled by A. So whatever instruction A will give to B, B will follow. So A plus B together holds 60%. So therefore C is a subsidiary because A directly and indirectly controls C. Previous was indirectly. Now it is directly and indirectly control C. So C will also be consolidated with A. Is it right? Now in this example, what will be the share in the net asset of C or profit in the C which A will enjoy? 20 is direct. 20 is direct. So 20 plus 60% into 40%. 24. So 20 plus 24. Anji. 44. Yes. So what about the balance? The balance will be with the others. Is it right? Just let me check. First, in example A, A group share of subsidiary C is determined at 48%, that is 80% into 60%, which A when A consolidates C. In example B, the group share of subsidiary C is determined at 52%. Why 52%? 20%, and then they have written 80% of 40%. But in the question above, they have written 60. So you just make it 80. Otherwise, your notes will become inconsistent. Done. So this diagram also you make it 80%. So 52%. Once you get this parent company right, balancing figure you write NCI, 48%. After doing this calculation, which we will call effective control over sub-subsidiary. So my one working note will increase this time. What is that one working note now? Effective control over sub-subsidiary. In our example right now, C Limited. Okay. And after getting effective control of main parent, ultimate parent, over the sub-subsidiary, then we'll calculate NCI stake in the sub-subsidiary, which is balancing figure. It can of course be mathematically also calculated, or it can be balancing figure. Is it right? Like in this example, balancing figure is 48%. Mathematically on the screen, in C Limited, 40% share plus 20, 60 are held by A and B, remaining 40 is with outsider. Remaining 40 is with outsiders. And then 80% shares are held by A and B, means 20% are held by outsiders. Is it right? So 20% of 40%, 8. 8 plus 40. 40 are direct NCI in C Limited. And NCI of B also has 8% stake in C. Is it right? So whatever C will earn, 8% of that will also go to NCI. Is it right? So that is 48%. Now how do you consolidate sub-subsidiary? So I'll give you a small 2-3 line note first. Write down. Notebook. Write down problems on chain holding. Or just give the heading chain holding. Point one, first check whether control exists over the sub-subsidiary. First check whether the control exists over sub-subsidiary. If parent plus other subsidiary of parent, if parent plus other subsidiary of parent holds more than 50% share in voting power, we will assume parent controls the sub-subsidiary. We will assume parent controls sub-subsidiary. Okay. And therefore sub-subsidiary will also be consolidated. Therefore sub-subsidiary will also be consolidated. Then step number 2, right? Calculate the effective interest of ultimate parent in sub-subsidiary. Calculate the effective interest of ultimate parent in sub-subsidiary. Okay. Then write down point number 3, date of effective control. If intermediate subsidiary already holds shares in, if intermediate subsidiary already holds shares in sub-subsidiary, then the date of effective control then the date of effective control is the date when ultimate parent acquired shares in intermediate subsidiary. Date when ultimate parent acquired shares in intermediate subsidiary. Okay, now to understand this line, suppose B acquired shares in C. B acquired shares in C on 1/4/2020, and A acquired shares in B on 1/4/2021. So who acquired shares first? B in C, then A in B. So what is the effective date of control? When did A start controlling C? From 1/4/2021. So write on effective date of control 1/4/2021. So this is my effective date of control. (clears throat) 1/4/2021, because then on that day we'll calculate the pre-acquisition profit of C, and post-acquisition will be after that date. So that affects my goodwill calculation, retained earning calculation figure. Now one more note, write down. If sub-subsidiary acquires shares in, if intermediate subsidiary acquires shares in sub-subsidiary later, intermediate subsidiary acquires shares in sub-subsidiary later, comma, the effective date of control will be, effective date of control will be the date sub-subsidiary acquired, the date the sub-subsidiary acquired, sorry, again mistake, the date when intermediate subsidiary acquired shares in, intermediate subsidiary acquired shares in sub-subsidiary, intermediate subsidiary acquired shares in sub-subsidiary. Okay, now I will change the example now. So first you write A acquired shares in B 1/4/2021. A acquired shares in B 1/4/2021. B acquired shares in C 1/4/2022. Now first who became subsidiary? B. Then who became subsidiary? C. So what is the effective date of control now? 22. So write down 1/4/22 is your effective date of control. Effective control date. Okay, so now we'll take a problem to get a good idea. So there is a question number 45. Question number 45. First we'll read this question number 45. Prepare the consolidated balance sheet as on 31st March 2082 of a group of companies comprising P Limited and S Limited and SS Limited. Their balance sheet as on that date are given below. Rupees in lakhs, PSSS, assets, non-current asset, property, plant and equipment, investment, then shares in S Limited, in P Limited book 340, and shares in SS Limited, in the balance sheet of S, is it 280? So who is the ultimate parent here? P. Who is the intermediate subsidiary? Who is the ultimate subsidiary or sub-subsidiary? SS, current asset, remaining balance sheet is easy. Inventory, financial asset, trade receivable, bills receivable. Tick mark bills receivable. You'll find bills payable is also appearing below. Cash and bank, equity and liability, shareholders equity, share capital rupees 10 per share, other equity, reserve, retained earning, current liabilities, financial liabilities, trade payable, bills payable. Now look at the bills payable. P Limited has to pay to SS Limited 30. P Limited has to pay to SS Limited bills payable of 30. And S Limited has to pay to P Limited bills payable 70. So 30 plus 70, 100. Go to asset side now. Bills receivable 72 plus 30, 102. So I will cancel how much? 100 on both side. And remaining bills receivable 2 will continue to appear in the balance sheet. Is it right? That may be outsider. So that remaining 2 will appear. Remaining 2 will appear and 100 will be cancelled. Okay. So one adjustment is inside the balance sheet itself. Then there are few simple adjustments. The following additional information is available. P Limited holds 80% share in S. And S Limited holds 75% share in SS. Their holding were acquired on 30th September 20X1. Good news. Both are acquired on the same date. So the effective date of control will be same, 30th September. What is the year ending date given to you? 31st March. 6 months of the current year profit and reserve will be pre and 6 months will be post. The business activity of all companies are not seasonal in nature and therefore it can be assumed that profits are earned evenly throughout the year. What is the purpose of this statement? You can apportion in 6:6 ratio. On 1st April 20X1, underline the date 1/4/2000X1, the falling balances stood in the books of S and SS Limited rupees in lakhs. Now they have given you the position of reserve on 1st April. S Limited, SS Limited, reserve and retained earning. For a moment, come to balance sheet, other equity. Look at the reserve of these two companies. It is 180. Whereas the note says on 1st April, it was 80 and 60. Which means in the current year, there is some profit which they have added to reserve. Okay, and then you look at the retained earning column also. In the balance sheet, retained earning of these two companies are 50 and 60. But on the 1st April, it was 20 and 30. So there is some increase in retained earning also. Okay, so in post acquisition, there are some change in reserve, there are some change in retained earning. Point number 4, rupees 10 lakh included in inventory figure of S Limited is inventory which was purchased from SS Limited at cost plus 25%. So there is an unrealized profit on stock. 25 by 125 into 10, 2 lakh. Tick mark inventory at the inventory on that balance sheet, asset side. Reduce it by 2. And who is the seller? SS Limited. Reduce it from the retained earning of SS Limited and then distribute it. And then distribute it after reducing the 2. Next point, parent company has adopted an accounting policy to measure NCI at fair value. Applying Ind AS 103, assume market price of S Limited and SS Limited are, underline, same as their respective face value. So market price is 10 rupees per share for both companies. So that will help me to calculate the NCI fair value on the date of acquisition. Okay. And to that, we will add the share in post acquisition reserve and share in post acquisition retained earning. Is it right? So first, what you do, based on the given question, we'll prepare a balance sheet. Consolidated balance sheet of P Limited as on 31st March 2022. As on 31st March 2022. Serial number, particulars, rupees in lakhs. Same format you will copy. Okay. In the question, the format is very appropriately given. You can use the same. Point number A, assets. 1. Non-current asset. Under that, Roman 1, PPE. Roman 2, intangible asset. One line blank. Then write 2, current assets. Under current asset, write Roman 1, inventories, and Roman 2, financial assets. Financial assets. Under financial asset, 3 items: trade receivable, bills receivable, cash and cash equivalent. One line blank, total. Again, one line blank, part B, equity and liabilities. Equity and liabilities. Under that, write 1, equity, A, share capital, B, other equity, C, NCI. Point number 2, current liabilities. In current liabilities, we have financial liabilities, trade payable. What about bills payable? Eliminated. So I will not write and waste my time and space. Bills payable will be fully cancelled. You want to write? Write minus 100, 0. Okay. Then below that balance sheet, you write down consolidated statement of changes in equity. Consolidated statement of changes in equity. Draw the format. First column, write share capital. Second column, reserve. Third column, retained earning. Fourth column, capital reserve. You can just draw it. If you get it, write it. If you don't, ignore, non-controlling interest, and total. Total. Then we will write format opening balance. Then just write NCI, because NCI there are two companies, so we'll have to do a lot of calculation. We'll take the total from there and write here. Okay. So NCI, write working note. We'll prepare a working note, and from there we'll just put the figure here. In earlier problem there was only one NCI, but in SOC I can't draw two NCI column. Yes or no? So we'll have to do working outside the SOCI for chain holding problem. And point number C, write down add post acquisition. Add post acquisition dash under that A, reserve, and B, profit and loss. Keep two lines blank, total. Then you write down working note 1. Working note 1, write this time calculation of effective interest of P Limited in SS Limited. Effective interest of P Limited in SS Limited. First, mentally you have to check whether SS is a subsidiary of P. Yes, because P and its subsidiary S, they are holding 75% share in SS. So P can control SS. So entities which you are controlling, you have to consolidate. And for consolidation purpose, we'll see what is my effective interest in that company. How much I will get? How much P will get? Is it right? So what is the answer? 60%. So you can write in any way you are comfortable. Point number A, write down acquisition by P Limited in S Limited 80%. B, write down acquisition by S Limited in SS Limited 75%. Therefore, effective interest of P Limited in SS Limited, multiply A into B, 60%. And point D, write down NCI interest. No, don't write interest again, because non-controlling interest, I stands for interest only. NCI in SS Limited 40%. So it is now as simple as this. You will divide the profits of the last company SS between parent and NCI in the ratio of 60-40, and the profit of S Limited is normal 80-20. Is it right? Now write down working note number 2, analysis of profit. Analysis of profit. So now write down two columns on the right side. Main column S Limited, SS Limited. Under S Limited, pre-acquisition, post-acquisition. Under post-acquisition, again, reserve and profit and loss separately. Why separately? Because reserve will be added with reserve and profit will be added with profit. So identity of post acquisition reserve is to be kept separate, then why not for pre-acquisition also? All pre-acquisition profit will go for goodwill calculation. So even if I write separately, I have to ultimately transfer it to goodwill working note only. But post-acquisition share in reserve will be added to reserve, and post-acquisition share in profit and loss will be added to profit and loss. So therefore, there is a distinction. SS Limited pre-post, under-post, two column reserve and profit and loss account. Keep around 15 lines blank. Then write down working note 3, goodwill or capital reserve. Goodwill or capital reserve. Is it right? 15 lines blank. Previous working note. Same format for goodwill or capital reserve. Serial number, particulars, right hand side, two columns this time. S Limited and SS Limited. Okay. One more column has come this time. SS Limited. Then under that, you write point number A, consideration paid. Point number B, NCI at fair value. NCI at fair value. Point C, total. Point D, net assets represented by. Under that one, share in share capital, or just write share capital. Share capital. Second, pre-acquisition profit. Point number two, pre-acquisition profit. From where will you get this pre-acquisition profit? Yes, from analysis working note. Working note 2, total D. Total D, and point number E, write down. Goodwill or capital reserve. When there are more than one subsidiaries, take total of all the subsidiaries, goodwill and capital reserve, and write in the balance sheet as one single figure. Okay. So we'll do that. Now write down working note 4, NCI. S Limited, SS Limited. Under that, point number A, fair value of NCI. Point number B, add share in post acquisition. Add share in post acquisition. Under that, 2 points, reserve, and below that, keep one line blank, P&L account. This time there is one new adjustment. What is that adjustment? Point number C, right? Less NCI share of, less NCI share of investment in SS Limited. Now first I will give you a note on that point number C. Write in bracket, read note below. After reading, writing, we'll discuss. So write, refer note below. So in chain holding problem, what is happening? The NCI of S Limited, NCI of, are not only enjoying the profit of S Limited, they are also enjoying the profit of SS Limited. Is it right? They are not only enjoying the profit of S Limited, they are also enjoying profit of SS Limited. So therefore, the investment made by S Limited, investment made by S Limited in SS Limited will also be apportioned between the parent and NCI. Will also be apportioned between parent and NCI. If you are getting the share in profit, then you must also bear the cost. Okay. Now, if I only take whatever is given in the question, it means they are only enjoying the profit, but they are not bearing the cost. So, they have to also bear the cost. So, for that, write a small note. The NCI in S Limited, what is NCI in S Limited? 20%. Will take its proportionate share in SS Limited. So they will also get 20% of SS Limited. Yes or no? So they will have to bear, their proportion in investment by, so they will have to bear their proportion in investment by S Limited in SS Limited. S Limited has made an investment in SS. Because of that, two parties are getting the benefit. The parent and the NCI of S Limited also. Is it right? So what we will do, that investment made by S Limited will allocate it to parent and NCI in the ratio of 80:20. 80% to parent and 20% to NCI. Okay. Because they are also going to get 20% of the profit of the SS Limited. Am I right? 20% of profit of SS Limited they will get because of this investment. So we will also apportion some cost of investment to NCI. That's a small adjustment we'll have to do. So what I'll do, while writing the consideration paid, see the balance sheet, asset side. What is the consideration paid for acquiring SS Limited? 280. The 280 will divide between 80% to parent, which will come in goodwill working note, and 20% will allocate to NCI, which will come in working note 4. Remaining calculation will go smoothly as usual. So this is a new adjustment for us. This problem will arise only in chain holding problem. If you are getting the profit, you bear the cost also. Is it right? Okay, so let us begin this wonderful question. Property, plant and equipment. Is there any adjustment there? No. So what will you do? Add. How much is the total of PPE? Tell me. Write 980 in the outer column. Next item is investment. Come to working note on goodwill. Point number A. Goodwill. Working note, point A, parent company and subsidiary company, 340. Now wait, don't write 280. 340 is right. Subsidiary company, we will follow the note. So we'll take 80% of 280 here. 224. Write 224 in bracket, right? 80% of 280 and then go to NCI, point number C, write in bracket here 20% of 280 in S Limited, line number C, 20% of 280, 56 plus or minus, these are all positive item, reserves item, and you are adjusting the cost. So negative. Don't add. Okay. Now next line is current asset. As usual, go to balance sheet. search for inventory. There is a small adjustment there. So you will write 220 plus 70 plus 50 minus 25 by 125 into 10. That is your unrealized profit on inventory. So what is the final amount? 338. And this 2 lakh which you have adjusted, go to working note 2. Right. Analysis of profit. Keep the first about 6 lines, 7 lines blank. Then write down less unrealized profit on stock. Who sold to whom? Subsidiary sold to its another parent, S Limited. Simple rule, the one who sold, reduce it from the profit of that party, because he has not realized that profit so far. Automatically all adjustment will be taken care of. Remove it from the profit of the seller. So second effect is over. Come back to balance sheet. Little fast now. Trade receivable, just give me total. Trade receivable, bills receivable, only 2. So you write in bracket 72 plus 30 minus 70 minus 30. So remove intra group transaction. Balance is 2, we don't know what is that 2. So assume it is other parties. Next line, cash and cash equivalent. Tell me the total only. 308. You can take current asset total in the outer column now. 1128. Now we'll come to equity and liabilities. Share capital. 1228. Check 1228. Okay. Even after eating breakfast, the effect has not gone. 1228. Afterwards, searching for the missing figure or the mistake is very difficult. Now come to consolidated statement of changes in equity, parent company, share capital. Write 600 here. Parent company reserve 180. Write 180 in reserve. Write parent company retained earning in opening balance, retained earning column 160. Capital reserve write dash. Non-controlling interest write dash. Tell me the total. 940. Okay. And then what about subsidiaries? Share capital, reserve, retained earning. So first we'll go to goodwill. In that goodwill, you come to point number D1, share capital. How much is that? 400, right there, 400. And what about the other party? 320. So 400, 320. This will also serve some more purpose. It will help me to find NCI at fair value. The problem says NCI will be measured at fair value, and fair value is equal to face value. Fair value is equal to face value. So what is the NCI interest in S Limited? 20%. Is it 20%? So what will be NCI at fair value in S Limited on the date of acquisition? 20% of 400. 20% of 400. Is it 80? And you write 20% into 400. What is the total NCI interest in SS Limited? Working note 1. Fourth line. You'll find 40%. Is it there 40%? Not 25, 40. Overall NCI. Direct NCI is 25. And NCI of S also has a role in SS also, their share. So altogether 40. 40% of 320. 40% of 320. Is it 128? Keep calculation ready here. Otherwise, afterwards you'll get confused. Okay. Everywhere. When we are distributing SS Limited figures, we will make it 40%. Okay. Only that consideration paid is shared between parent and NCI. So 80-20. Other figures, 40% for NCI. Can I take the total now? 420. Did you call me 420? No. Then 300? 352. Go to working note 4 also. NCI at fair value. Source write down working note 3. 80. 128. Written. Okay. Now we'll come to working note number 2, analysis of profit. And for that, you have to read Roman 3 adjustment. On the date of acquisition, the balance in reserve and retained earning in S and SS Limited is given to you. So what are these figure? Pre-acquisition figure. These are opening pre-acquisition figure. So write like this, reserve. Reserve 1420X1. S Limited pre column 80. SS Limited pre column 60. Then write down retained earning. Retained earning 1420X1. Again pre column 20. Again SS Limited pre column 30. Then write down reserve dash current year in the ratio 6:6. Reserve of current year in the ratio 6:6. Now keep balance sheet in front of you. How much is the reserve of S Limited in balance sheet? You can see 100 there. Out of 100, 80 is on 1420X1. Correct? This 80 is on 1420X1 and balance sheet figure is 100. So what is the current year reserve created? 20. And that also will apportion in time ratio 6:6. So up to 10 will go to pre, and in post reserve column 10. Agreed? Same thing you do for SS Limited. Go to balance sheet of SS. Reserve is 80. 80 minus 60. 60 is their reserve on 1st April. So 20 current year. 20 divided by 2. 10 in pre, 10 in post. Correct. Now write down retained earning dash current year in the ratio of 6:6. Exactly same thing. Again, balance sheet retained earning S Limited is 50. 50 minus opening retained earning 20. 30 divided by 2. 15 in pre, 15 in post P&L account column. Yes or no? SS Limited balance sheet retained earning is 60. 60 minus this 30. 30 divided by 2. 15 pre, 15 P&L account post. That was so easy. Next, reserve ho gaya, retained earning we have done. Now we'll come to current liability in the balance sheet. So that balance sheet will be over. In balance sheet, current liability, trade payable, tell me the total. Who will tell me fast? Is it 880? 880. total of all three companies without adjustment. What about bills payable? Disappeared. Already deducted. See on the screen, asset side, bills receivable, minus 70, minus 30. Done. Adjustment number 1, over. 2, over. 3, over. 4, over. 5, over. Actually, all adjustments we have done now in the process of this exercise. So what I'll do, I'll go to analysis of profit. Working note number 2, analysis of profit. Draw one line and take the total of all columns. Carefully, slowly, silently, take the total. Done. Now answer. First column, you said 125. Write 125 here. Second column, 10. Third column, fourth column, 115. Then 10, 13. Draw a line, take the total. Done. Now you write down here in the particular column P Limited and NCI. In S Limited, the ratio will be 80-20, correct? And what will be the ratio in SS Limited? 60-40. 60-40. So what you do, and don't apportion that pre-acquisition. Why? Pre-acquisition, I have to fully write in goodwill working note. So you don't apportion pre-part, only apportion post-part, like we did in so many problems earlier. So can you just tell me 80% of 10, 8, below that 2, 80% of 15, 12 and 3, 60% of 10, 6 and 4, 60% of 13, 7.8 and 5.2. Done. What about pre-acquisition? Transfer it to goodwill working note. Line number D2. Pre-acquisition profit as per working note 2. 125. Total of D. 525 and 435. So what is goodwill or capital reserve in the first column? 420 minus 525. 105 negative. So that is capital reserve. And again negative, capital reserve. Now below that write down total capital reserve. 100, how much? 188. Go to statement of changes in equity. In statement of changes in equity, we have to insert one more line. Gain on bargain purchase. Point number D, gain on bargain purchase. GOBP means gain on, and in which column we will write? How much you said? 188. Total column 188. Total column also 188. So that one figure we have transferred, and then it will go to balance sheet on its own. Now, dear student, come to NCI. Now, all NCI profit in the working note to last line will go to NCI working note. Understood? So in working note to last line, NCI share in S Limited reserve is 2, penal account is 3. So you will write like this, working note 4, S Limited column share in post acquisition reserve 2 and profit and loss 3. Wait a minute. Now similarly, SS Limited last line share of NCI in reserve 4 and 5.2. So you will write 4 and 5.2. Okay. Wait a minute. Take total of S Limited NCI 80 plus 2 plus 3 minus 56. Is it 29? And take total of SS Limited 128 plus 4 plus 5.2. 137.2. Now take total of both. 166.8. 22. Okay, don't get angry. 166.2. 166.2. Now this covers all adjustment. So just I will go to NCI in SOCIE and write in that NCI column 166.2. See, we can give more and more presentation, but time is a big constraint. Okay. So what is the total? 166.2. And one more thing is pending. Parent share in the post acquisition reserve and P&L account. So parent share in post acquisition reserve was how much? I'll go to working note 2 to explain. 8 in S Limited and 6 in SS Limited. 8 plus 6, 14 we will write. 14. Okay. And in P&L account, P&L account, do the same exercise. Do the same exercise. Can you see? P&L account 12 and 7.8. 19.8. In retained earning column, 19.8. Now what you do, first complete each line, row, each row. 0, first line is complete, second line is complete, third line pre-acquisition reserve, 0, 14, dash, dash, 14. Then dash, dash, 19.8, dash, dash, 19.8. Now you will take total of all columns, share capital 600, reserve 194, reserve 194, and retained earning 179.8, capital reserve 188, NCI 166.2, last column total 12 1328. In NCI you write down working note here, working note 4, otherwise you'll wonder how this has come. Now what is the total of all these three reserve item? 561.8. So I will transfer 600 share capital in the first column, and then I will write 561.8 other equity. I will take total in the outer column. How much is this total? 1161.8. 8, and then I will write NCI also in the outer column, 166.2 is right. Now I am ready to take the total. 22, write down on the liability side also, 2208. Understood. This is over. Assumption right. It is assumed that SS Limited had sold the good in the post-acquisition period. It is assumed that SS Limited had sold the goods in the post-acquisition period. Now check the answer on the screen. Balance sheet is appearing on the screen. In the post-acquisition period, hence adjusted in post P&L account. But otherwise this is not required. In every problem you have to assume this only, unless the problem specific instruction is given. Hence adjusted in post P&L account. This is not to be written also, because in this chapter we will assume the same thing every time. Now we'll continue tomorrow.